Electromagnetic radiation. The word radiation in our culture has taken on boogeyman status. It's like, oh my god, there's radiation. Fear! But of course, radiation just means something that is radiating. In fact, if you look at the word radiate, radius, it means going out radially. That's all it means. But okay, when we talk about something radiating, it means that something is flying off of something else. And that could be anything. So, yes, when we talk about nuclear radiation or radioactive radiation, it's charged particles or neutral particles coming off. But electromagnetic radiation is just light. Now, some of that can do bad stuff to you. Gamma rays are just light, but they can do serious damage to your cells. Infrared radiation, sometimes people call that heat, and that is incorrect, because heat is the flow of energy through contact. It has to do with vibrations of molecules, and then bumping into other molecules and making other molecules vibrate. That's what heat really is. But then if you hold your hand over a stove burner and you feel your hand heating up or getting higher temperature, really what it is infrared radiation off of the burner that your hand is then absorbing. It's radiation, it's infrared radiation, it is just light, but of course you get close enough you can burn your hand. So infrared radiation can do damage, invisible radiation can do damage, all of these things can do damage if they're in enough intensity. So, electromagnetic radiation is light. The first question is just sort of your basic, you know, all the definitions question. So what is the wavelength? And I'm going to write down the variables we often use for this. So wavelength, lambda, frequency, F, period, which we use capital T. So, and by the way, I should just say lambda is a Greek L, so that's why it's length, frequency, T, time, that kind of makes sense. Angular frequency, we use omega, I don't know why, but we do, that's the Greek letter omega. And wave number, we use K, which maybe is unfortunate because it's not Boltzmann's constant, which we've seen K. It's not the spring constant, which we've used for K, so K gets used for a lot of different things. So we want all of these things for red light. Now, unfortunately, you can't just do this from first principles. The first thing you have to do is go and look, well, what is the wavelength of red light? So you can look at the notes I gave you in class. And there's a range. I'm going to pick 650 nanometers because it turns out red is not hard to find as exactly this one wavelength. It's a range of wavelengths that we all call red. So fine, 650 nanometers is in that range, and so we'll go with that. Great, and from that we can figure out all the rest of these. I'm going to start with the wave number because remember the wave number is 2 pi divided by the wavelength. So that's going to be 2 pi divided by 650 times 10 to the minus 9th meters. That's what a nanometer is. I'm going to do all of these in pieces, and then I'll just do them all on my calculator at once. Okay, then for the frequency, we know that the wavelength times the frequency, actually let's do period first because it's a little more obvious. Wavelength divided by the period is equal to the speed of light. So if you have a little wave here, in one period, it moves one wavelength over. So it goes distance wavelength in time period. That's the speed of light. So therefore, the period is just lambda divided by C, which is 650 times 10 to the minus 9th meters, divided by 2.99792, check me out, times 10 to the 8th meters per second. Right, spastic number of significant figures there. Great, that's what the period's going to be, so we've got that one. And now the frequency is just 1 over the period. So I'll put that, I'll just do that in my calculator when I'm done with this one. I'll also invert it, and I'll get that. And then finally, omega is equal to 2 pi f. So once I have the frequency, I can calculate all of that. So that's all you have to do to calculate all of these. So I'm going to start with wave number. That'll be done. Then I'll do period. Then I'll get frequency and omega from the period. So let's go ahead and put that in my calculator. Righto. So, first of all, wave number. We have 9666438. How ugly. That's fine. It's 9. I'm going to have to write this small to make sure it all fits. 9666438 meters to the minus 1. All right, that's the units. It's got meters down there. Or it's cleaner to write it as, and I do the right number of sig figs, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 9.7. times 10 to the 6. I do believe that. Let me tell you why I didn't believe that. I thought, wait, I was dividing by 10 to the minus 9th. That's 6 divided by 6. I should have gotten 10 to the 9th. Oh, but look, if this is really 10 to the minus 7th, right, because 650 times 10 to the minus 9 is 6.5 times 10 to the minus 7th, and 9 times 10 to the 6 is almost 10 to the 7th, so actually it is what I would have expected doing it in my head to get close. So that is the wave number. Great. Then I just did this calculation, lambda divided by C, and I got 2.16817 times 10 to the minus 15th. Right, so think about that for a moment. And it's meters divided by meters, then we have seconds in the denominator of the denominator. So it's seconds here. All right, 10 to the minus 15th, so a billionth of a second is 10 to the minus 9 seconds. So the time it takes red light to go through one cycle, to do for the electric field to go right, one of those, is 1 millionth, or really 2 millionths of 1 billionth of 1 second. This is why you don't count them, because it's really fast. Great, so then F is just 1 over T. So that's equal to 1 divided by 2.16817 times 10 to the minus 15th seconds. So that is 4.6122 times 10 to the 14th seconds. 6, sorry, I said that wrong. I'm going to say 10 to the 14th hertz, because we use hertz for frequency. What hertz really is cycles per second. And cycles is just a number. How many cycles is it? So it goes through 10 to the 14th cycles per second. That's the frequency of red light. And then finally, omega is equal to 2 times pi times F is 2 times pi times 4.6122 times 10 to the 14th hertz. And again, I'm keeping extra digits for intermediate numbers, although this is the last one I'm going to do, so I won't keep extra digits. I get 2.9 times 10 to the 15th seconds to the minus 1. Now, and let's just think about it. Well, 5, that's about 6. 5 times 6 is about 30. That's about 30. 10 to the 14th, good. Now, you might say, wait, these are the same units, because 2 pi is just a number. So hertz, this should still be hertz. And dimensionally, hertz and 1 over seconds are the same thing. But the difference is hertz really means cycles per second. Omega is in radians per second, and usually we quote it as seconds to the minus 1. So we don't really have the equivalent thing, but we don't ever use 1 over the wavelength anyway, or at least I don't. So seconds to the minus 1, when you see that, you should think that's 1 over seconds, or maybe radians per second, whereas hertz means cycles per second. That's what we would use for a frequency as opposed to an angular frequency. So we have all these numbers, so I'm going to write them all up to the right number of sig figs up here. So K was 9.7 times 10 to the 6th meters to the minus 1. The period T was 2.2 times 10 to the minus 15th seconds. The frequency was 4.6 times 10 to the 14th hertz. And the angular frequency was 2.9 times 10 to the 15th seconds to the minus 1. So yay, we've got all those numbers. Now there is another part to this question. And that is, how many red photons would it take to equal the energy of a 90-mile-an-hour fastball? Right, so we have a 90-mile-an-hour fastball, which we're going to want to convert to meters per second. Now, there's one little thing when I say the energy of the fastball. What energy do I mean? And if you think about when does a fastball really happen, you have a pitcher and you have a batter, and the pitcher's going to throw the fastball. And you realize, hey, wait a minute, there's some potential energy between when the pitcher throws it and when the batter catches it. Uh-oh. There's certainly kinetic energy, and as you will learn in a couple weeks, there's mass energy. I'm going to leave the mass energy out. Why? Not because if you're a full-on relativistic physicist, the mass energy is part of the energy of the baseball, but it's not going to be converted into anything else. You're going to have a mass of a baseball and still a mass of a baseball. Let's just not include that because that's not really relevant to a pitcher throwing a pitch. The potential energy is, but I'm also going to ignore it. Why? Because it's small compared to the kinetic energy. And if you don't believe that, think about this. All right, so look at the ceiling of whatever room you're in. Hopefully it's like 4 feet up or 5 feet up, something like that. And I'm going to tell you, either, you have two choices. Either I'm going to drop a baseball on your head from 4 feet up, or a fastball pitcher is going to throw a 90-mile-an-hour fastball at your head. Which would you prefer? And assuming that you are not a unredeemable masochist, your answer to that question tells you, hey, this baseball has way more kinetic energy than potential energy. You could also do the calculation to verify. So I'm just going to include the kinetic energy of a 90-mile-an-hour fastball. So that's the energy of the fastball is 1/2 mv squared. The energy of one photon is just hc over lambda, or hf, whichever you prefer. Same thing, because c over lambda is f. And I'm saying how many, I'm using gamma as the symbol for a photon, how many red photons would it take to equal the energy of a fastball? So if I have one, multiply it by the number I have the total energy in red photons. That has to equal the energy of the fastball. So n gamma is just going to equal energy of the fastball divided by energy of this, which is 1/2 mv squared divided by h, we'll say h lambda. Sorry, that's wrong, hf, because we have f over there. H is 6.626 times 10 to the minus 34 joule seconds. And I have to look up the mass of a baseball because I forgot. It's like 250 grams, I think. But I'll check that, and I'll put all these things in my calculator. All right, so some of the numbers. The mass of the baseball, I remembered wrong. It's more like 145 grams, or 0.145 kilograms. 90 miles per hour. If you do the conversion of, oh dear, I don't remember what it is anymore, but however many meters per mile, look that up, times 1 hour divided by 3,600 seconds, right? We will cancel the per hour, right? Miles per hour really means miles per hour. We'll cancel the miles. We'll have what it comes out to is 40.23 to too many sig figs, but it's an intermediate number, so we keep the meters per second. So I put in that M, I put in this V, all right? I get that the energy of a fastball is 117.34 joules to too many sig figs. I put in this H, I put in this F, and I get the energy of a red photon is 1.44 times 10 to the minus 48. No, Rob, that's wrong. Okay, as you'll see when I get to the second problem, I do some numbers and I recognize the numbers do not match what I just got. So fix, here's what I did wrong. First of all, if you just think about H times F, 10 to the minus 34 times 10 to the 14 should give you 10 to the minus 20, right? Minus 34 plus 14, 10 to the minus 20. And yet I had a very wrong number there. We also have like a 6 times 4, which is like 24. So we should come up with something like 10 to the minus 19 or so for H times F. So what I did is I just multiplied by the wrong number. And so this is one of the reasons I recommend you actually always write out all of your numbers so that you can make sure you're multiplying by the right thing. So it's 0.145 kilograms, and then V squared is 40.23 meters per second squared. Divided by H is 6.626 times 10 to the minus 34. Joules times seconds is kilogram meter squared per second, because joule is kilogram meter squared per second squared, and you times seconds, it gets rid of one of those. And then here's the thing I did wrong, I put in the wrong F, is 4.6 times 10 to the 14th. And what I'm gonna write this as 1/2 seconds. So we can see second squared, kilogram, cancel, meter squared. So the units work out, and I'm gonna put that in my calculator. Okay, and so again, I'm just gonna tell you, this comes out as 117 joules for the fastball. I did that right. Here's the one I did wrong. It is 3.1 times 10, or actually, we have extra sig figs, 3.056 times 10 to the minus 19 joules, right, is what we got. So, right, so the 10 to the minus 19. So that's what, doing this thing in your head of looking at the powers of 10 and making sure the answer you get is reasonable is a really good idea. So that's what I did wrong. It turns out I put the period instead of the frequency in here. So of course I was wrong by a factor of 10 to the 30. Oops, that was bad. Anyway, when you divide these two, you get 3.8 times 10 to the 20. Right, that is the number of photons in a 90 mile an hour fastball. So, like, for example, suppose it had a little box, you throw baseballs at it, boom, it takes the baseball, stops it, takes all that kinetic energy and boom, turns it into a pulse of red light, boom, and 100 joules in red light all at once, boom, all in one direction. That's pretty good. You know, it's a 100 watt light bulb, is 100 joules per second. So if it sent that pulse out in a fraction of a second, it'd be really intense. But we'll deal with intensity in the next problem. And you'll also see me get all worried in the next problem. This number is consistent with the thing I was worrying about in the next problem. So that's really the end of the first problem. And the second problem, a red laser pointer emits light at a wavelength of 635 nanometers. So here you go. You've been zapped by a laser. Pew, pew. See, you see, I don't know if you can see the dot. We'll see when I look at the video later. This thing on the back here says 640 to 660 nanometers. I told you 635 nanometers. It's okay. I missed a little bit. Who cares? It's still red. It's still very close. This also says class 2 laser product. FCC, you don't care. It says max output less than 1 milliwatt. So when I pew, 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 pew you, and look at that CCD, never mind. I'm not going to tell you about CCD blooming. When I zap my hand, I'm zapping my hand with less than a milliwatt. So it doesn't really hurt. But do not do this in your eye, because a laser straightener, I can burn out your retina. So I don't recommend that. Suppose that the laser has a circular spot that is 1 millimeter in radius. So now what's happening is, I have to use my red pen because it's a red laser pointer. Right, I'm shining a laser on, and I'm going to exaggerate the size of the spot. So there's light coming in, and it's all laser light. And you can tell it's laser light because it says pew pew. Right, lasers make pew pew sounds. I learned that watching Star Wars, except those weren't lasers, it was something else, but who knows. And it makes a spot on the wall that is 1 millimeter in radius. And we're going to assume it's uniform illumination within the spot. It's not exactly, but whatever, it's not too bad. It says it's uniform, and that it produces 3.5 milliwatts. So this is a laser that's maybe four times more powerful than the one I have there. You can get those. That's not too hard. Good. How many photons per second is the laser producing? Well, all right. So the total power is the total amount of energy, which are called delta E, delta T, which means the change in energy added to the light beam in time delta T. Well, okay. So delta E, delta T is that. Well, what is delta E is going to be the number of photons times the energy of one photon divided by delta T. And then the number of photons times, and the energy of the photon is hc over lambda divided by delta T. And I do it this way because lambda is what we have, the wavelength. I'll write any as one fraction is that. What we're really after is n gamma, so let's solve this for n gamma. So that's b times lambda times delta T over hc, that is the number of photons being produced, and time delta t. So we can put in 3.5 times 10 to the minus 3 joules times seconds times 635 times 10 to the minus 9 meters times delta t 1 second, saying how many photons are produced in 1 second. That's how you know delta t is 1 second. Divided by 6.626 times 10 to the minus 34 joule seconds times 2.99792 times 10 to the 8th meters per second. If you check units, this here should have been joules seconds to the minus 1. It's joules per second. So joules cancel joules. Seconds to the minus 1 cancel seconds. These seconds cancel those. Meters cancel meters. No units are left. It's just a number, so we can stick it in the calculator. We get 1.15 times 10 to the 16th photons per second. You'll say, wait a minute, there was no per second in there. Well, really what I got was n gamma. If I divided both sides by delta t, divided by the 1 second, I'd have photons per second. So n gamma, that's the number of photons produced in 1 second. Now you may say, wait a minute, what happened to that huge number that we had from the fastball? Well, and the reason there, I'm actually a little disturbed by that, because the fastball had an energy that was 5 orders of magnitude larger, so I should have had 10 to the 21 with the fastball, and I got 10 to the 48. I've done something wrong. I probably did something wrong with the fastball. So I'll check that, and I'll go back and fix it. But in the meantime, this is the number of photons. Let's just make sure this makes sense here. It does, right? So we have 10 to the minus 7 minus 3, that's 10 to the minus 10. And we divide by another 10 to the 8, so that's 10 to the minus 18. And then to go from 18 to 34, is like 18, and then with all the other things, 10 to 16 actually seems like a reasonable answer to this. That's fine. I'm going to go with this and assume that it is correct for the time being, and wonder what I did wrong in the fastball problem. Good. What is the intensity of the laser light at the spot in watts per meter squared? All right, this is not needed for that. Remember, the intensity is just the power delivered divided by the area. So that's actually pretty easy. The intensity, that's just the power over the area, is 3.5 times 10 to the minus 3 joules per second, right? So that's what, 3.5 times 10 to the 5 milliwatts. So it's that many joules in 1 second. And the area is pi times 10 to the minus 3 meters squared. You have to remember to square the 10 to the minus 3 as well as the meters. So when you do this, I can tell you what this is going to come out to about, because 3.5 divided by pi is approximately 1. We have 10 to the 3 divided by 10 to the 3 minus 3 squared. This is going to come out to about 10 to the 3. I'll do it in the calculator. And yes, we get 1114, so very close to 10 to the 3 watts per meter squared, or to the number of sig figs. We actually have 3 sig figs, as I told you. No, I only gave you 2 sig figs in the milliwatts. So we'll call it 1100 watts per meter squared. Now that sounds like a lot, right? Think about a 100 watt light bulb spread out all over, I say, a 10 by 10, pretty small room. That's 100 watts spread over 10 by 10. A 10 by 10 wall is 100 meters squared, right? And then you've got 6 walls, but let's just forget about that for the moment. 100 watts divided by 100 square meters is 1 watt per square meter. So the intensity of this laser light is a lot more than the intensity of a standard light bulb. And that's why you can see this. You can see this red dot, because the total energy is less, but it's concentrated in a much smaller area, so the intensity is higher. So boom, that's why you can see it. This is also why you don't want to shine it on your retina. Okay, suppose that laser light is completely linearly polarized. What is the amplitude of the electric and magnetic fields and the light waves emitted by the laser? Now for that, we're going to use the fact that the pointing vector is all right, it's 1 over mu naught E cross B. You may have noticed a little cut there. I always forget what constants are in front. I know it's E cross B, I always forget the constants. I could figure it out from the units. I decided to just look it up. So that's the pointing vector. All right, so in linearly polarized light waves, so if we have light going that way, the electric field vector would wiggle like that. The magnetic field vector would wiggle like that. So the electric field is going up, down, up, down. And the magnetic field is going left, right, left, right, left. And then E cross B, that would be light going out in that direction. Okay, so that is what the pointing vector is. Well, and so then the intensity of the light has the same as the magnitude of the pointing vector, which is going to be E times B over mu naught, because E and B are perpendicular. So the magnitude of the cross product is just the product. And remember, B's amplitude is just E over C. So that's E squared over mu naught C. Or E is equal to the square root of mu naught C I. Okay? So now I can just put these numbers in. So mu naught is 4 pi times 10 to the minus 7th. And then let's see if I can remember what the units of mu naught are. It's Tesla amps per meter. And Tesla, well, I'll just put it in for now. Tesla amps per meter. And then I'll expand. Tesla is Newton seconds per Coulomb meter. It's not. It's Tesla meters per amp. I'm sorry, I did that wrong. It's Tesla meters per amp. I won't tell you how I'm remembering that. If you want to know, just come ask me. So it's Tesla meters per amp. And then Tesla is Newton seconds per Coulomb meter. So the meter will cancel this, but we'll pull another seconds up here. So it becomes, well, so there's another Coulomb down there, another second there. It's Newtons per amp squared. Okay, that's good. Although, you know what, let's call it Newton seconds squared per Coulomb squared, because that'll be more useful. Fine, at the end of that, then we multiply by C, and that is 2.99792 × 10⁸ meters per second, and times the intensity, which we just calculated, is 1114. A watt is a joule per second, and a joule is a newton meter per second. So this comes out to newtons per meter second. All right, so if we go ahead and deal with our units, meters cancel meters, seconds times seconds cancel seconds squared, we get newtons squared per coulomb squared. We're going to do a square root. We'll get newtons per coulomb. That's what we want. So this is E. I should have gotten rid of that squared when I took this square root. So I'll put that in my calculator. All right, and when all is said and done, we get an electric field of about 650 newtons per coulomb. Now the question is that a lot? Well, compared to what? So the electric field over the surface of the Earth, if memory serves, is something like, that's just ambiently there because there's charges around and stuff, is something like 100 newtons per coulomb. So there's always an electric field like that. You may remember when we first did the sticky tape lab, you had electric fields that were an order of magnitude or two bigger than this. So this actually isn't really a lot, but that's okay, that's what it is. So that's the electric field that you would have in this little laser beam. The one that I was actually shining was less than this by a factor of, say, I don't know, two or three, because the intensity was down. Well, so it was less than this by a factor of, say, two, because the intensity is down by something like a factor of four, or the power is down by a factor of four, and because there's a squared there, that's what does it. Anyway, that is the second problem, working out all kinds of stuff about light. Third problem. Suppose that light, really I should say, suppose that some light, or the light that you have, is composed of photons that each have one eV of energy. So we know that hc over lambda is equal to hf is equal to one eV. If there are a lot of these photons, it's possible to observe this light entirely as a wave, right? It's just like water molecules. You have enough of them, it becomes a fluid, water. What would be the wavelength, frequency, period, and color of these light waves? So let's start with frequency because that's the easiest one. Although notice here, right, so you're really tempted to say, oh, so F is going to be 1 divided by 6.626 times 10 to the minus 34 because that's H, and I'm going to get wrong answer. And the reason is because you should put units on it. And if you put EV on, and then you put joule times seconds on, now you have the right answer, but you notice, oh, wait, the units don't all cancel out. Oh, let's do a unit conversion. So what I'm going to do is take this 1 EV, and I'm going to multiply it by 1.602 times 10 to the minus 19th joules per EV. Now, you may recognize that number. Let me see. Wait a minute. That's also the number of electron charges in a coulomb, and that's where the word electron volt comes from. The idea is that you have something, suppose I have like a parallel plate capacitor with a delta V of 1 volt, and I stick something with a charge of E, say a proton. So the proton has plus the charge on the electron, right? Charge on the electron is negative, but the fundamental constant we use, E, is just 1.602 times 10 to the minus 19th coulombs. And we let it accelerate. How much kinetic energy does it have here? Well, it's going to equal Q delta V, and Q is E, which is E delta V, right? So it'll be whatever that is. Well, we define this amount of energy to be 1 electron volt. So that amount of energy is how much energy would an electron have if accelerated through a potential difference of 1 volt, or anything with the charge of the electron, right? So how much energy would an electron have if accelerated through the potential difference of 1 volt? Well, because if you put in a 1 here, and you put in 1.602 times 10 to the minus 19th coulombs there, times 1 volt, you'll get 1.602 times 10 to the minus 19th joules, right? So that's why that many joules is 1 electron volt. So just an aside about units there. So now that we know that number, at least in principle, actually, we know it. I can do this in my head. Can you multiply this by 1 in your head? Yes, I can. 1.602 times 10 to the minus 19th joules. Okay, electron volts cancel electron volts. And now I can say F is equal to H over E gamma. I did that wrong. Is equal to E gamma over H, right? E gamma is the energy of one of these photons. So now I can say that's 1.602 times 10 to the minus 19th joules divided by 6.626 times 10 to the minus 34 joules times seconds. All right, so the units will be good. Joules will cancel joules. I have 1 over seconds. I'm going to call it hertz because this is a frequency. 16 divided by 66 is something like, I don't know. It's going to be like 1/4, a little bit less than 1/4. 34... So 19, we've got 34. 34 minus 19 is 15. So I expect something like 2-ish, 2 to 3-ish, 10, 2-ish, 10 to the minus 16 when I put it in my calculator. I'm pretty dumb. Right, I did that all wrong. So minus 19 minus minus 34 gives you plus 15. And so it was about a quarter times plus 15, so it should have been like 2.5 times 10 to the 14. So whatever, sine error, who cares? Anyway, there's the frequency. The wavelength is equal to C over lambda, C over F, right? Lambda, because lambda times F is C. That's really good. So we can do this, 2.99792 times 10 to the 8th meters per second. I just like putting lots of digits on the speed of light because I am like that. 418 times 10 to the 14th hertz. So hertz will cancel 1 over seconds. We'll get something in meters. Let's get 1.240 times 10 to the minus 6 meters, which is the same as 1,240 nanometers, or 1.240 micrometers, or sometimes just called microns. What was the other thing he was asking for? Period is 1 over F. Right, so that is just 1 divided by 2.418 times 10 to the 14th hertz is 4.136 times 10 to the minus 15th seconds. All right, so answers to the right number of sig figs. Well, it looks like there's only one. I'm going to keep two. F is 2.4 times 10 to the 14th hertz. Lambda is 1.2 micrometers, or 1,200 nanometers to two sig figs. 1,240 if you want to keep the third sig fig. Period is 4.1 times 10 to the minus 15th seconds. What is the color? So you go and you look at your little infrared chart and you realize, hey, wait a minute. Visible light only goes up to something like 750 or 800 nanometers. This is longer than this. This is in the near infrared, as it's called. So this is infrared light. The light you are radiating because you are warm is actually longer wavelength than this by maybe a factor of 5 or 10. But this is near infrared light. This is, in fact, the wavelength of light I used to look at when I was doing my graduate thesis, at looking at galaxies in that light. We called it the J-band. Nobody cares. So there you go. That's the third problem. You're giving some kind of silvery metal. You don't know what kind of metal this is, but you're told that it's either potassium or uranium, and you believe whoever told you that. To figure out which it is, the easy thing to do would probably be to measure the mass and volume of each sample and figure out the density, but you don't want to have any truck with this easiest business. Make it hard, it's more fun. Instead, you get a particle detector capable of measuring the speeds of electrons in a monochromatic source of soft ultraviolet light. So our light is at 320 nanometers. So that's, we call that soft ultraviolet because it's only a little bit below the edge of the visible spectrum. As you get to shorter and shorter wavelengths, it's hard ultraviolet, and then eventually X-rays. You shine the light on the metal, and you measure that electrons come off with a maximum speed of 3.1 times 10 to the 5th meters per second. You say, okay. So what that means is some of the energy of the photon comes in with H nu, and the electron goes out with energy 1/2 mv squared, but it takes, so you have your electron down here, it takes the work function's amount of energy to get it out. So what we're going to do is I'm going to calculate what's the work function of this metal and compare it to potassium and uranium. So what we know is that the total energy coming in the photon, has to equal the work function of the metal plus 1/2 times the mass of the electron times v squared. That's how much energy it takes to get an electron out. This is the energy of the emergent electron. W is what we're after, so I'm just going to do H nu minus 1/2 MeV squared, except instead of nu, oh, sorry, HF, we're using F for frequency in this class. Instead of F, I'm going to use the fact that lambda times F is equal to C, because lambda is what we have. So HC over lambda minus 1/2 MeV squared, that's 6.626 times 10 to the minus 34 joules times seconds. divided by, times 2.99792 times 10 to the 8th meters per second. Right, seconds cancel seconds, divided by 320 times 10 to the minus 9 meters, cancels meters, minus 1 half times the mass of the electron, 9.109 times 10 to the minus 31 kilograms, times the speed of the electron, 3.1 times 10 to the 5 meters per second squared. All right, I do that subtraction in my calculator. All right, and the result I get for this difference is 5.77 times 10 to the minus 19th right, and we go and we look, and it tells us uranium is 3.6 and potassium is 2.3. This is clearly neither one of those. Oh yeah, I have to do units, right? This was joules, right? So I had kilogram meter squared per second squared. I had joules, so joules minus joules is still joules. And I've given this in EV, so I better do the conversion. So I have 5.77 times 10 to the minus 19th joules, and I need to convert because I'm given it in EV. So let's convert this to EV. 1.602 times 10 to the minus 19th joules is 1 EV. So if I divide 5.7 by 1.602, 6, 12, 18, 1, 2, 3, it's going to be like 48, so it's going to be a little more than 3. And in fact, I actually did it in my calculator, and guess what I got? I got 3.6 EV, and that is the work function of uranium. So these data are consistent with uranium. Had it been potassium, which has a lower work function, we would have had faster electrons coming out. The photoelectric effect. And that is the end of the problems for today.